Falk, A Reminiscence by Joseph Conrad, read by Donald Miller. Several of us, all more or less connected with the sea, were dining in a small river hostelry not more than 30 miles from London, and less than 20 from that shallow and dangerous puddle to which our coasting men give the grandiose name of German Ocean, and through the wide windows we had a view of the Thames, an effulgent view down the lower Hope Reach. But the dinner was execrable, and all the feast was for the eyes. That flavor of salt water, which for so many of us had been the very water of life, permeated our talk. He who hath known the bitterness of the ocean shall have its taste forever in his mouth. But one or two of us, pampered by the life of the land, complained of hunger. It was impossible to swallow any of that stuff, and indeed there was a strange mustiness in everything. The wooden dining room stuck out over the mud of the shore like a lacustrine dwelling. The planks of the floor seemed rotten. A decrepit old waiter tottered pathetically to and fro before an antediluvian and worm-eaten sideboard. The chipped plates might have been disinterred from some kitchen midden near an uninhabited lake, and the chops recalled times more ancient still. They brought forcibly to one's mind the night of ages when the primeval man, evolving the first rudiments of cookery from his dim consciousness, scorched lumps of flesh at a fire of sticks in the company of other good fellows. Then, gorged and happy, sat him back among the gnawed bones to tell his artless tales of experience, the tales of hunger and hunt, and of women, perhaps. But luckily, the wine happened to be as old as the waiter. So comparatively empty, but upon the whole fairly happy, we sat back and told our artless tales. We talked of the sea and all its works. The sea never changes, and its works, for all the talk of men, are wrapped in mystery. But we agreed that the times were changed, and we talked of old ships, of sea accidents, of breaking downs, dismastings, and of a man who brought his ship safe to Liverpool all the way from the River Platte under a jury rudder. We talked of wrecks, of short rations, and of heroism, or at least of what the newspapers would have called heroism at sea, a manifestation of virtues quite different from the heroism of primitive times. And now and then, falling silent altogether, we gazed at the sights of the river. A P&O boat passed bound down. "One gets jolly good dinners on board these ships," remarked one of our band. A man with sharp eyes read out the name on her bows, Arcadia. "What a beautiful model of a ship," murmured some of us. She was followed by a small cargo steamer, and the flag they hauled down aboard while we were looking showed her to be Norwegian. She made an awful lot of smoke, and before it had quite blown away, a high-sided short wooden bark and ballast and towed by a paddle tug appeared in front of the windows. All her hands were forward, busy setting up the headgear, and aft a woman in red hood, quite alone with the man at the wheel, paced the length of the poop back and forth with the gray wool of some knitting work in her hands. "German, I should think," muttered one. "The skipper has his wife on board," remarked another. And the light of the crimson sunset, all aboard, behind the London smoke, throwing a glow of Bengal light upon the bark spars, faded away from the Hope Reach. Then one of us, who had not spoken before, a man of over 50, that had commanded ships for a quarter of a century, looking after the bark now gliding far away, all black on the luster of the river, said, "This reminds me of an absurd episode in my life, now many years ago, when I got the first command of an iron bark, loading then in a certain eastern seaport. It was also the capital of an eastern kingdom. Lying up a river, as might be London lies up this old Thames of ours, no more need to be said of the place. For this sort of thing might have happened anywhere, where there are ships, skippers, tugboats, and orphan nieces of indescribable splendor, and the absurdity of the episode concerns only me, my enemy Falk, and my friend Hermann. There seemed to be something like peculiar emphasis on the words "my friend Hermann," which caused one of us, for we had just been speaking of heroism at sea, to say idly and nonchalantly, "And was this Hermann a hero?" "Not at all," said our grizzled friend. "No hero at all. He was a skiffurer, ship conductor. That's how they call a master mariner in Germany. I prefer our way. The alliteration is good, and there is something in the nomenclature that gives to us as a body the sense of corporate existence. Apprentice, mate, master, in the ancient and honorable craft of the sea." As to my friend Hermann, he might have been a consummate master of the honorable craft, but he was called officially skiffurer, and had the simple, heavy appearance of a well-to-do farmer, combined with the good-natured shrewdness of a small shopkeeper. With his shaven chin, round limbs, and heavy eyelids, he did not look like a toiler, and even less like an adventurer of the sea. Still, he toiled upon the seas in his own way, much as a shopkeeper works behind his counter, and his ship was the means by which he maintained his growing family. She was a heavy, strong, blunt-bowed affair, awakening the ideas of primitive solidity, like the wooden plow of our forefathers. And there were, above her, other suggestions of a rustic and homely nature. The extraordinary timber projections, which I have seen in no other vessel, made her square stern resemble the tail end of a miller's wagon. But the four stern parts of her cabin, glazed with six little greenish panes each, and framed in wooden sashes, painted brown, might have been the windows of a cottage in the country. The tiny white curtains and the greenery of flower pots behind the glass completed the resemblance. On one or two occasions, when passing under stern, I had detected from my boat a round arm in the act of tilting a watering pot, and the bowed, sleek head of a maiden, whom I shall always call Hermann's niece, because as a matter of fact, I've never heard her name, for all my intimacy with the family. This, however, sprang up later on. Meantime, in common with the rest of the shipping in that eastern port, I was left in no doubt as to Hermann's notions of hygienic clothing. Evidently, he believed in wearing good stout flannel next to his skin. On most days, little frocks and pinafores could be seen drying in the mizzen rigging of his ship, or a tiny row of socks fluttering on the signal halyards. But once a fortnight, the family washing was exhibited in force, the poop entirely. The afternoon breeze would incite to a weird and flabby activity all that crowded mass of clothing, with its vague suggestions of drowned, mutilated, and flattened humanity. Trunks without heads waved at your arms without hands, legs without feet kicked fantastically with collapsible flourishes, and there were longer white garments that, taking the wind fairly through their neck openings, edged with lace, became for a moment violently distended by the passage of obese and invisible bodies. On these days you could make out that ship at a great distance by the multicolored grotesque riot going on abaft her mizzenmast. She had her berth just ahead of me, and her name was Diana. Diana not of Ephesus, but of Bremen. This was proclaimed in white letters a foot long, spaced widely across the stern, somewhat like the lettering of a shop sign, under the cottage windows. This ridiculously unsuitable name struck one as an impertinence towards the memory of the most charming of goddesses. For apart from the fact that the old craft was physically incapable of engaging in any sort of chase, there was a gang of four children belonging to her. They peeped over the rail at passing boats and occasionally dropped various objects into them. Thus, sometimes, before I knew Hermann to speak to me, I received on my head a horrid rag doll belonging to Hermann's eldest daughter. However, these youngsters were upon the whole well behaved. They had fair heads, round eyes, round little knobby knees, and they resembled their father a good deal. This Diana of Bremen was a most innocent old ship, and seemed to know nothing of the wicked sea, as there are on shore households that know nothing of the corrupt world, and the sentiments she suggested were unexceptionable and mainly of a domestic order. She was a home. All these dear children had learned to walk on her roomy quarter-deck, and such thoughts there is something pretty, even touching. Their teeth, I should judge, they had cut on the ends of her running gear. I have many times observed the baby Herman, Nicholas, engaged in gnawing the whipping of the royal brace. Nicholas's favorite place of residence was under the main fife rail. Directly he was let loose, he would crawl off there, and the first seaman who came along would bring him, carefully held aloft in tarry arms, back to the cabin door. I fancy there must have been a standing order to that effect. In the course of these transportations, the baby, who was the only peppery person in the ship, tried to smite these stalwart young German sailors on the face. Mrs. Hermann, an engaging stout housewife, wore on board baggy blue dresses with white dots. When, as happened once or twice, I caught her at an elegant little washtub rubbing hard on white collars, baby socks, and Hermann's summer neckties, she would blush in girlish confusion and, raising her wet hands, greet me from afar with many friendly nods. Her sleeves would be rolled up to her elbows, and the gold hoop of her wedding ring glittered among the soap suds. Her voice was pleasant. She had a serene brow, smooth bands of very fine hair, and a good-humored expression of the eyes. She was motherly and moderately talkative. When this simple matron smiled, youthful dimples broke out on her fresh, broad cheeks. Hermann's niece, on the other hand, an orphan and very silent, I never saw attempt to smile. This, however, was not gloom on her part, but the restraint of youthful gravity. They had carried her about with them for the last 3 years, to help with the children and be company for Mrs. Hermann, as Hermann mentioned once to me. It had been very necessary while they were all little, he had added in a vexed manner. It was her arm and her sleek head that I had glanced one morning through the stern windows of the cabin, hovering over the pots of fuchsias and mignonette, but the first time I beheld her full length, I surrendered to her proportions. They fix her in my mind as great beauty, great intelligence, quickness of wit, or kindness of heart might have made some other woman equally memorable. With her it was form and size. It was her physical personality that had this imposing charm. She might have been witty, intelligent, and kind to an exceptional degree. I don't know, and this is not the point. All I know is that she was built on a magnificent scale. Built is the only word. She was constructed, she was erected, as it were, with a regal lavishness. It staggered you to see this reckless expenditure of material upon a chit of a girl. She was a youthful and also perfectly mature, as though she had been some fortunate immortal. She was heavy, too, perhaps, but that's nothing. It only added to that notion of permanence. She was barely 19, but such shoulders, such round arms, such a shadowing forth of mighty limbs. When, with 3 long strides, she pounced across the deck upon the overturned Nicholas, it's perfectly indescribable. She seemed a good, quiet girl, vigilant as to Lena's needs, Gustav's tumbles, the states of Carl's dear little nose, conscientious, hard-working, and all that. But what magnificent hair she had, abundant, long, thick, of a tawny color. It had the sheen of precious metals. She wore it plaited tightly into one single tress hanging girlishly down her back, and its end reached down to her waist. The massiveness of it surprised you. On my word, it reminded one of a club. Her face was big, comely, of an unruffled expression. She had a good complexion, and her blue eyes were so pale that she appeared to look at the world with the empty white candor of a statue. You could not call her good-looking. It was something much more impressive. The simplicity of her apparel, the opulence of her form, her imposing stature, and the extraordinary sense of vigorous life that seemed to emanate from her like a perfume exhaled from a flower, made her beautiful with a beauty of a rustic and Olympian order. to watch her reaching up to the clothesline with both arms raised high above her head caused you to fall a musing in a strain of pagan piety. Excellent Mrs. Hermann's baggy cotton gowns had some sort of rudimentary frills at the neck and bottom, but this girl's print frocks hadn't even a wrinkle, nothing but a few straight folds in the skirt falling to her feet, and these, when she stood still, had a severe and statuesque quality. She was inclined, naturally, to be still, whether sitting or standing. However, I don't mean to say she was statuesque. She was too generously alive, but she could have stood for an allegoric statue of the earth. I don't mean the worn-out earth of our possession, but a young earth, a virginal planet, undisturbed by the vision of a future teeming with the monstrous forms of life and death, clamorous with the cruel battles of hunger and thought. The worthy Hermann himself was not very entertaining, though his English was fairly comprehensible. Mrs. Hermann, who always let off one speech at least at me in a hospitable, cordial tone, and in plat Dutch, I suppose, I could not understand. As to their niece, however satisfactory to look upon, and she inspired you somehow with a hopeful view as to the prospects of mankind, she was a modest and silent presence, mostly engaged in sewing, only now and then, as I observed, falling over that work into a state of maidenly meditation. Her aunt sat opposite her, sewing also, with her feet propped on a wooden footstool. On the other side of the deck, Hermann and I would get a couple of chairs out of the cabin and settle down to a smoking match, accompanied at long intervals by the pacific exchange of a few words. I came nearly every evening. Hermann I would find in his shirt sleeves. As soon as he returned from the shore on board his ship, he commenced operations by taking off his coat. Then he put on his head an embroidered round cap with a tassel, and changed his boots for a pair of cloth slippers. Afterwards, he smoked at the cabin door, looking at his children with an air of civic virtue, till they got caught one after another and put to bed in various staterooms. Lastly, we would drink some beer in the cabin, which was furnished with a wooden table on cross legs and with black straight-backed chairs, more like a farm kitchen than a ship's cuddy. The sea and all nautical affairs seemed very far removed from the hospitality of this exemplary family. And I liked this because I had a rather worrying time on board my own ship. I had been appointed ex officio by the British consul to take charge of her after a man who had died suddenly, leaving for the guidance of his successor some suspiciously unreceipted bills, a few dry dock estimates hinting at bribery, and a quantity of vouchers for 3 years' extravagant expenditure. All these mixed up together in a dusty old violin case lined with ruby velvet. I found besides a large account book, which, when opened, hopefully turned out, to my infinite consternation, to be filled with verses, page after page of rhymed doggerel of a jovial, improper character, written in the neatest, minute hand I had ever seen. In the same fiddle case, a photograph of my predecessor, taken lately in Saigon, represented in front of a garden view, and in company of a female in strange draperies, an elderly, squat, rugged man of stern aspect, in a clumsy suit of black broadcloth, and with the hair brushed forward above the temples in a manner reminding one of a boar's tusks. Of a fiddle, however, the only trace on board was the case, its empty husk, as it were. But of the two last freights of the ship had indubitably earned of late, there was not even the husks left. It was impossible to say where all that money had gone to. It wasn't on board. It had not been remitted home, for a letter from the owners, preserved in a desk evidently by the merest accident, complained mildly enough that they had not been favored by a scratch of the pen for the last 18 months. There were next to no stores on board, not an inch of spare rope or a yard of canvas. The ship had been run bare, and I foresaw no end of difficulties before I could get her ready for sea. As I was young then, not 30 yet, I took myself and my troubles very seriously. The old mate, who had acted as chief mourner at the captain's funeral, was not particularly pleased at my coming, but the fact is the fellow was not legally qualified for command, and the consul was bound, if at all possible, to put a properly certified man on board. As to the second mate, all I can say is his name was Totterson, or something like that. His practice was to wear on his head, in that tropical climate, a mangy fur cap. He was, without exception, the stupidest man I had ever seen on board ship. He looked it, too. He looked so confoundedly stupid that it was a matter of surprise for me when he answered to his name. I drew no great comfort from their company, to say the least of it, while the prospect of making a long sea passage with those two fellows was depressing, and my other thoughts in solitude could not be of a gay complexion. The crew was sickly, the cargo was coming very slow, I foresaw I would have lots of trouble with the charterers, and doubted whether they would advance me enough money for the ship's expenses. Their attitudes toward me was unfriendly. Altogether, I was not getting on. I would discover at times, generally about midnight, that I was totally inexperienced, greatly ignorant of business, and hopelessly unfit for any sort of command. And when the steward had to be taken to the hospital ill with choleric symptoms, I felt bereaved of the only decent person at the after end of the ship. He was fully expected to recover, but in the meantime had to be replaced by some sort of servant. And on the recommendation of a certain Schomburg, the proprietor of the smaller of the two hotels in the place, I engaged a Chinaman. Schomburg, a brawny, hairy Alsatian, and an awful gossip, assured me that it was all right. First-class boy, that, came in the suite of His Excellency Tseng the Commissioner, you know. His Excellency Tseng lodged with me here for 3 weeks. He mouthed the Chinese Excellency at me with great unction. The specimen of the suite did not seem very promising. At the time, however, I did not know what an untrustworthy humbug Schomburg was. The boy might have been 40 or 140, for all you could tell, one of those Chinamen of the death's head type of face, and completely inscrutable. Before the end of the third day, he had revealed himself as a confirmed opium smoker, a gambler, a most audacious thief, and a first-class sprinter. When he had departed at the top of his speed with 32 gold sovereigns of my own hard-earned savings, it was the last straw. I had reserved that money in case my difficulties came to the worst. Now it was gone. I felt as poor and naked as a fakir. I clung to my ship, for all the bother she caused me, but what I could not bear were the long, lonely evenings in her cuddy, where the atmosphere, made smelly by a leaky lamp, was agitated by the snoring of the mate. That fellow shut himself up in the stuffy cabin punctually at 8, and made gross and revolting noises. It was odious not to be able to worry oneself in comfort on board one's own ship. Everything in the world, I reflected, even the command of a nice little bark, may be made a delusion and a snare for the unwary spirit of pride in man. From such reflections, I was glad to make any escape on board that Bremen Diana. There apparently no whisper of the world's iniquities had ever penetrated, and yet she lived upon the wide sea, and the sea tragic and comic, the sea with its horrors and its peculiar scandals, the sea peopled by men and ruled by iron necessity, is indubitably a part of the world. But that patriarchal old tub, like some saintly retreat, echoed nothing of it. She was world of proof. Her venerable innocence apparently had put a restraint on the roaring lusts of the sea, and yet I have known the sea too long to believe in its respect for decency. An unelemental force is ruthlessly frank. It may, of course, have been Hermann's skillful seamanship, but to me it looked as if the allied oceans had refrained from smashing these high bulwarks, unshipping the lumpy rudder, frightening the children, and generally opening this family's eyes out of sheer reticence. It looked like reticence. The ruthless disclosure was in the end left for a man to make, a man strong and elemental enough and driven to unveil some secrets of the sea by the power of a simple and elemental desire.